afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I feel privileged to stand here today, and I thank the Maroon Express for inviting me to share some of my experiences on peace initiative and peace building. As I'm going to talk about the Mothers Association, and I would like to first make it clear that whatever achievements, whatever failures we have faced, is all a teamwork. Failure was also our teamwork, our team failure, and the success also is all a team success. That I want to make it clear. And this is the first time that I'm going to share about the beginning of the Mothers Association initiative. I want to say that, you know, those days we did not recognize our role as peacemakers, but only after we started working for peace activities among the factional groups of our people, we realized that whatever we have been doing from the day one of our establishment, whatever we have been doing is all a peace process that we have been doing. Because it was on 14th February, under the leadership of Mrs. Sanova Muzo and a few others, and the mayor was formed. And after a series of discussions in that meeting, we decided that we will name it as Mothers Association, because at that point in time, the social evils prevailing was mainly on drug addiction, pornography sale, and video halls. People were running all kinds of, many places were running video halls and showing pornographic films at that point in time. So these were the main social evils for us to recognize that. And on drug addiction, some of our families, some of our mothers, they have had the first-hand experience on their children's addiction. So we decided to fight against the social evils like all this. And since 1984 till 7th June 2007, I've been involved in Naga Mothers Association. So whatever I can remember, whatever I have experienced, I'm going to share that. Those days, as we geared up ourselves to fight for the social evils, we had been approaching the government, the administration, police, excise, for closing down of video halls, and then stopping the sale of pornography magazines, and to stop drug trafficking. We became very busy. Along with the government agencies, we started going for action. And in those actions, most of the days we were occupied in something or the other, only to find out how we can fight against all these issues. And it was in 84, 85, we were given more attention towards prevention of drug trafficking. And in the process, the women of Kuzama village, at that time, the drug heroin was coming from Imphal, mostly. So the women of Kuzama village, we could motivate them to give assistance to the Chekget police prisoners. And how they did that was just to encourage the police prisoners to be more dutiful in their checking. The women have organized themselves in that village, and from each household, a cup of rice was collected from all the houses in that village, and the rice was given to the police at the check gate. And sometimes vegetables were collected and given to them, so that the police personnel knows that the mothers are against this trafficking, and they want to see that police becomes more sincere and dutiful in their duties. So that's how it began. And from 84, 85, okay, then in 84, we had just started like that as volunteers, and there was no money, there was no fun, but the work was continuing. And the Kohima village women, in the same year, that was in 1984, 13th November, the Kohima village women decided to organize a football exhibition, and it was played in the playground. And in that football exhibition, we got 13,000 rupees. And then with that money, we started going for more activities. Then in 85, 86, we were traveling to different areas, different places, different localities to create awareness on all these issues that women from all colonies should be prepared to be watchful against the drug traffickers and video halls. At the same time, we also had a series of discussions on how to stop our children from this addiction. We did not know the meaning of what is the addiction at that time, but we only knew how to stop our children from drugging. So with different agencies, we had started consultations, and we realized that unless we start doing something to rehabilitate these affected children, we cannot change the situation. So in order to have some establishment like that, it became necessary for us to have a registration again, so that with this recognized registration organization, registered organization, we could also seek for financial assistance from the Ministry of Social Welfare. So it was in 1986, November again, October, we had registered a branch of the main Naga Mothers Association as Women, Youth and Welfare Organization. So under this organization, we had taken up the different projects. And that's how we started a rehabilitation center as Mount Gilead Hall. That was in 89. With all our limitations, we have started the home. But we also again realized that to give treatment for these children, we needed a professional support. So we were looking forward how to get this kind of support from some professionals who are already in the field of rehabilitation. Somehow, one of our own men, Mr. Nikitu Iralu, was based in Bombay those days. So we contacted him to find out if there is any organization who are doing rehabilitation work. So through him, we came to know about the Kripa Foundation, Bombay. So NMA invited a team of Kripa Foundation expertise, like doctors, psychiatrists, and the founding members. So it was in 1989 May, they visited Nagaland, and we took them to all the districts of Nagaland to assess the situation. And from them, we learned that we need to nurture, we need to make a human resource, we need to establish a proper place where professionals can directly deal with those patients, with those addicts. So developing of human resource became one of our needs again. So we sent some of our children for counseling training in Bombay. And at the same time, we could also refer lots of cases to Bombay for treatment. And many of them have recovered from there, and they're still recovering. And most of our counselors have learned training from them. So that's how we started running our facility on our own. Then during the early 90s, most of you may not have seen the crisis those days, but in Kohima and Dimapur, in the early 90s, maximum factional killings had taken place. Every day you will find unidentified dead bodies, sometimes two, sometimes four, or sometimes one. The worst period of factional killings had taken place in the early 90s. So while running our office as a rehabilitation center, also as NMA office, we have just started growing by then. This crisis had came up again. So as mothers, people look upon us how to facilitate the dead bodies burial. So we were so fully occupied in contacting the administration, police, and since there was no ceasefire at that time, we had no other way but just to facilitate their burial ground for their burial ground. Or Kohima Town Committee. We had Kohima Town Committee, DC Office Kohima, Police Station, and NMA. We had started working together to dispose of the dead bodies. And after seeing so many dead bodies continuously for so many days, we realized in the beginning, somehow we started covering the dead bodies with whatever traditional shawls we get in and around us. We covered their bodies, but it became too much for us. We could not afford anymore. So what we did, we had made an appeal to the different churches in Kohima for the collections of shawls to cover the body of all these unidentified bodies. To the best of my knowledge, around 40-50 dead bodies were arranged with shawls, and none of them have been buried unmourned. one point of time, we even contacted some of our referents in Kohima. And one day, in one case, what happened was, it was already late in the evening. Maybe it was in monsoon, around 5:30 to 6. Only we could take the dead body for burial that time. So what happened? There was one reverend was there, one church leader, one lady was there. Only three of us, with police, we went to the site. And lots of things were happening at that time. Killings were also going on. So when the reverend said, "Okay, let us pray," I got scared to close my eyes. Can you imagine? Because I was thinking that anybody may be just firing from anywhere. You know, even to that extent we have experienced. It was very sad. But somehow, it was properly arranged and buried. We don't know whose son is he, from which faction, but so many have died, and we were not in a position to approach any group because we do not know which group he or she belongs, and no group had come to claim. Only after the ceasefire declaration, we felt free to approach different groups, and then we started appealing to them for unity and reconciliation. Our main approach was how to bridge the gap among them. That was our main approach. And one of the most significant events that we had held was we set aside a day for mourning for all those deaths. And it was and around 3,000 women gathered together in Kohima State Academy Hall. And it was on that day we resolved that NMA will make a peace team, none less shed no more blood. And with that team, we had started our journey towards peace initiative among our own people. I think there are many more things have happened, but I think Kishiri has many things to tell you in between. If necessary, I can come in. So that's all for the time being. Thank you very much.